am Diksha. I am 21 years old. I am a graduate in applied psychology from Gandhi College. I work as a legislative assistant to a member of parliament, Kiran K. And in this winter, I am going to go to Harvard University to pursue my master's in public policy. But apart from that, since 2.5 years, I've been doing spoken word poetry. Now, that's not really a hobby Sharma Auntie's sons would take up, because most people don't really know what it is. So spoken word poetry is an art form where the poet writes something for the sole purpose of performing it, which means that it has explicit imagery, it has more direct metaphors, and it has some sort of like a semi-colloquial style. So I'm going to demonstrate and start off with a poem today, and some context about this poem that once someone asked me that if there was a room full of white people and you had to talk about one theme, what is that one theme you would talk about? And I chose to talk about this. This piece is called Translated Cuisine. I grew up watching Translated Cuisine. In Translated Cuisine, the Hannah Montana show had an Indian theme song. So we never really heard Miley Cyrus singing, we just saw a group to the backdrop of our ironical translation of Best of Both Worlds without knowing another version even existed. And the high school music group was like a social experiment in knowing all the tunes without knowing any of the original lyrics. And then they had Harry Potter movies. They'd go a step ahead and change names of characters, like Moni Myrtle became Mayus Meena. And I did not know then that identities could be lost in translation, but the first time I saw Lizzie McGuire in English, lip-sync perfect, like a taste of cheese and cherry wine sangria, I felt like I had known a different character all along. Maybe that's how you'd feel if I shed foreign syllables from my mouth like spaghetti and slipped into the nightgown of my mother tongue today. My mother does not understand English. And frankly, there is no other language I'm competent enough to write poetry in. At McDonald's, her mind is a probable impossible, secretly asking me to place her order because she won't fumble with extra large if she never talks right. My mother is not mother but Phineas and Ferb of our house. The genius of two in one woman alone, the smartest woman I know. Until she is put through translation. Then she is every Facebook comment put through my literary council before being posted online. Her longest comment till now is God bless you. She knows this race. She also knows the English names for all my achievements because happens they always come from proving I know my second language better than my first. A rancid murmur in my ear that says we will call you a poet, not a traitor. I am a descendant of a family of multilingual folk who are synonymous to non-English speaking, who sent me to English school so I could be better than them. Because speaking English in India is status. English in India is, look, I have a verbal Mercedes. English in India is sucking up to the colonialists but forgetting they left a long time ago, the first time I gave the white guy. I would sometimes get words from my native language slipped into our text that would reflex and dismiss them as titles. What a beginning for a classically conditioned fear of words to ground further. I've seen my accent turn around the edges of people who own this language. Every her becoming a her. Every thank you becoming a thank you. This is not conformity, this is surrender. How I cannot write this poem in anything but English so you would understand it. Is this burden of proof or already found guilty? Somewhere a generation of millennials is debating what language to call their first when they haven't spoken the other in years. They say we feel things in the language we speak. Think in the language we speak. So maybe my feelings are dual. Maybe my thoughts are dual too. Maybe I am in two parts and I can never be whole until I let go of one of my identities. Maybe America is 500,000 immigrants but 1,000,000 identities. Maybe I am a Disney lost in translation. A Disney on Disney and two countries know different versions of me. You don't get the best of both worlds when one world rules your other. Maybe I have just one world and the other drags along. Because darling, how can you keep the story when you change the theme song? We all know how the Jungle Book ended. Sometimes where you were born is not where you belong. When the syllables rolling off your tongue, they tangle, be brave and shoot the pair behind you and wish with all of your heart that it be yet one last breath. What make it languageless? Make it meaning that does not tell words or words. Because somewhere in La La Land, Emma Stone will say, my aunt used to live in Paris. I remember she used to come home and she would tell us and it will always be relevant what her aunt told her. When our words are spilled from a white carpet to red and they give it laurels of golden plated ladies looking like they're already defending themselves. Everybody celebrating the movie and not the language of privilege it comes from. You know, maybe 50 years later, artists will ask us, Mom, how do white people make themselves so big we all look small? How do they do it? And we tell them, kid, first you burn the whole world down, bring it to its knees, then pretend to put out the flames. Make fire extinguishing a profession. They'll call you prince, and they'll never remember who lit the fire. Thank you. So, the question arises that why this art form needs to come up because you already had poetry, right? You all were reading Wordsworth when you were like, what, 5, 5th grade? So what was the need for this art form to come? I believe that poetry earlier used to be a realm of the intellectuals and the elite, which means that the well-read could understand it and the even more well-read could write it. And this sort of created an exclusivity in the art form, which made it opaque to the power that verbal expression really has. So, you know, as long as you could write well, you could make well-written and well-consumed pieces, but it wasn't really coming from a place of catharsis or obsession. And the second reason was that when the artist was writing something, there was no way of learning how the audience is validating or responding to it, which can be really empowering. If you know how an audience is responding to you, it can be really empowering to what you have to say. So even though there was sporadically in places, there were storytelling art forms, there was some performance poetry formally being done, the two reasons, that exclusivity of making it a realm of the elites, and the second one, that there was no engagement with the audience, was the reason that there was no, there was certain need for having something that was consistent and legitimate, such as spoken word poetry. So then there was a contemporary wave of, you know, spoken word poetry coming up as an art form. Non-artists were, going across and performing poems, and there was, they could have engagement with the audience in real time. So what happened when this art form came up? What was the relevance that this art form came up and it changed the world? How did it change the world? I believe that spoken word poetry gave a mic to the oppressed to tell their stories. So spoken word spaces are, you know, safe spaces where the oppressed tell their stories and feel held by the audience. The second thing that it did was it helped us mobilize. So when last year in February the ABVP attacks happened in RamjasCollege, in this seminar hall itself, I wrote a poem called Songs of Dissent, which was actually the name of the seminar, and I performed it in various BUMNs, various spoken word spaces, and that helped me help the students rage against ABVP. So the power of language in helping people mobilize and rage is also something that this art form gave. So if you see, the foundation of spoken word spaces was empathy. You didn't have to write a perfectly crafted piece, you didn't have to have the best poetry abilities, but you did have to have something to say, and people empathize with you. So that was the relevance of this art form. Now why do I do spoken word poetry? I come from a patriarchal household in a small town. I do it to talk about my identity as a woman, the gender roles and the shame I have to battle as a woman. As a psychology student, I do it to talk about mental health issues. And I also do it to talk about how I feel as a brown person in a pan-racial global community. Now, should you do it for the same reason? No. Because in spoken word poetry, how organic your story is or how organic your poem is what really matters. So while I may have a lot to say about body shaping, you may not, and that's fine. But as long as you find that one thing inspiring in your experiences to write about, to talk about, the audience will snap at you and the audience will quote you. So that in a sense is how this works. But I'm here today to talk about things you should not be doing in spoken word poetry, or things you should not be doing spoken word poetry for. Or as I call it, three things to know before writing a poem. The first thing is that always tell your own story, or how we call it in the spoken word community, stay in your lane poet. Now what this means is that if you are not a black person and you are writing a poem in the first person as a black person saying that I faced a lot of racism and everything, it's not allowed. Now why this is not allowed, that's two reasons. The first is what I call empathy crisis. So what happens in spoken word spaces is that the audience empathizes with you. Now, if there is an Indian Muslim coming up and saying that I went through a lot of compartmentalization and I was discriminated against and I feel really bad as an Indian Muslim, I feel that this time is not feasible to live in, then the audience is going to empathize with it. But now if a non-Indian Muslim also comes up and says that I didn't go through anything, I feel awesome when I walk on the streets and I think this government is totally, taking my religion forward or something, even then the audience doesn't know who to empathize with, right? This is what I call the empathy crisis. And for an art form that is based on on empathy, that is founded on empathy. It is not allowed to tell someone else's story in the first person. Of course you can tell it in the third person. You can say that Dalits are being discriminated against, and you should not. But you cannot say, if you are not a Dalit, you cannot say that I am a Dalit and you should talk to me as if I am a Dalit and you should listen to my experiences like I am black. Another reason this should not be happening is because it validates the voice of the poet and does nothing for the oppressed that they're talking about. So in India, there was a poem called The Legal Rapist, done by a male poet talking about marital rape in the first person, saying things like, I'm sorry for having my periods on a Saturday night, and you know, all this shit. And he was called really brave. When this poem came out, he was called brave and he was applauded for talking about it, but it wasn't his trauma to talk about because he's never been through it. And what it did was, is it validated the voice of a male person talking about a woman's tragic trauma, and it did not really encourage any woman to come forward and talk about it, because of course with the context that it's coming from, it wouldn't encourage the people who are like you to talk about it, right? So the two reasons are the empathy crisis and it validates the voice of the poet. Now the second rule or something like I call it ethic, is that talk about things that affect you, not things that are trending. So there is a bottom-up approach and there is a top-down approach. The top-down approach is you see an issue that's trending and you talk about it. The bottom-up approach, which I follow, is you talk about something and make it trending. Now why this is relevant is because if we all talk about trending issues, who is going to talk about equally relevant lesser-known issues? If all members of parliament tomorrow, over 700 of them, decide to talk only about demonetization or GST in the parliament, who is going to talk about forest rights? And who is going to talk about the antibiotics crisis? Do you guys know that the world is treading towards an antibiotics crisis, which means that in a few years, all the antibiotics we have will be ineffective because we have developed resistance to them, which means that we are going to die in a few years in the most common place, diseases. Talks about this, how are we ever going to start discourse around this? And that's how it works in spoken word poetry as well. Every time you write a poem, you add to the discourse, and please choose to add meaningfully to it. So just because something is not trending, it isn't that you can't talk about it, and just because something is trending, it doesn't mean that you have to talk about it. Which brings me to the third tool, which is edit. Now when you're telling a story, you get one chance to tell your story. Editing is relevant because it is only then that you can do justice to the story that you're telling. And the second reason that editing is really relevant is because sometimes when we write about social issues, it's an innate ability to rant about them rather than tackle them in a different way. So when I wrote a poem on a couple of cereals, I was so angry about them that the first draft that I had was completely a rant. It was all like, your women wear makeup to the kitchen and your women always hate other women, and that's all it was. Then I read through it during my editing phase and I realized this is only adding to the conversation and piling up on it. What is an audience taking away from this piece? Which is when I decided to use the tool of redefinition. So what I did was, I used the names of the series and I redefined them in my poem. Like, kyunki saas bhi kabhi socially independent thi, kyunki bahu bhi kabhi education minister thi, kyunki gender roles hai kahani ghar ghar ki bade acche lagte hain, men who are not entitled to think we owe them love bade acche lagte hain, slow motion mein sexism ko bash karne wale narratives, kaisa ye pyaar hai jo abuser se kiya, kaisa ye pyaar hai jo husband ko please karne bhi nahi kar diya. So I did this and this is what. Used a tool was metaphorical criticism, which is what you heard in this poem. Translated with me, I could have talked about how English is a hegemony in India, but I chose to use a metaphor of Disney Channel to translate Disney Channel to talk about it and criticize it in that way. The trick is to make the audience think that they arrived at the conclusion that we were trying to make them arrive at. Because when you preach to the choir, you're actually running the risk of making them defensive. So a tool that I always use is something that makes the audience arrive at what I'm trying to tell them, and of course redefinition. Which brings me to the conclusion that the reason we use spoken word poetry is to give someone the language to fight their battles. Which means that sometimes when you are brave enough to talk about your experiences, something that you think is inspiring in your life, but it's difficult to talk about, someone on the other side of the world may just get the language to fight their battle. Someone may have just gotten the language to tell their mom not to watch it, but a good series. So once I wrote a poem on high functioning depression, which means a kind of depression where you are functional, you're very productive, and it lasts over years, but yet, even despite being an overachiever, you still have depression, and people fail to see this kind of depression when I wrote about it. There were so many people who reached out to me to ask how they can help, how they can seek help about this kind of depression, which is what I'm trying to say, that sometimes when you talk about something that you think is relevant, but it isn't relevant, it isn't something that is not your story, and you edit it well, then you may just give someone the language to fight their battles. And eventually, this is what spoken word poetry is about, and this is the reason I do this art form. Thank you so much.